Welcome to our talk about the detection of refugee boats on the Mediterranean. It's a really difficult word. With a drone by using free and open source software. As the title says, it's mainly about software today, at least for the part I did in this project. But of course, there's some hardware involved, and this nice drone is provided by the nice people of Augsburg, which are building the drone. And it's a nice, it's good that we have it here, that you have a really nice direct example or the hardware directly here, that you can understand it even better what we are talking about. So let's begin. I wanna first give you a short introduction in the topic about refugee roads in the Mediterranean in general, refugee roads, and then we're gonna continue how search and rescue missions on this topic are made for refugees on these roads, and then we're going to talk about the Search Ring project, which is trying to do search and rescue missions by using this drone. Therefore, we're going to talk about the requirements which are needed to build this drone and to build the software. And we're going to talk about the plane as the hardware and the software to make it fly. We're going to talk about the computer vision to detect the people. We're going to talk about the current progress of the project. And we're going to talk about the work packages which are currently in work. And we're going to be working on them. And we want to conclude with the open source we use to build this project. So let's start. We're gonna talk about the refugee routes first of all. Of course, there are impossible routes for the refugees. That's why they go with a boat over the Mediterranean, and they cannot go by ferry. They cannot go by plane. That's why they need to do this life risking and inhumane routes over the sea. And this is mainly because there is a law, a European law, which is which was introduced in the year of 2001, and it's not because of 9/11. It's the Council Regulation 539, which says that you cannot go to you cannot travel to a country in Europe without having a visa, and you need to travel to a country in Europe if you want to apply for a refugee status there. It's only possible if you are there in the land. You cannot apply for the status outside of the Europe. That's the problem of it. And you can see here some countries, and the color green says you can apply for a tourist visa to go to Europe for 19 days, but the most countries in the world, the gray ones here, they are not allowed to go to the European countries without having a visa. And the black ones even are more restricted in a way that they are not even allowed to fly over a country in the Europe without a visa. So this situation, or this law, produces this current situation. We have three main spots in the sea where people try to cross it. So the numbers over here are not people, it's the number of cases which are recorded from in the last 10 years. I'm not sure. It's the alarm phone organization. They provide a hotline where you can call if you are in distress on the sea. And every single case they received a call, a number here is increased. And you can see here that there are mainly three spots. It's in the Strait of Gibraltar, it's next to Libya, and it's from Turkey to Greece. And these three spots we want to cover. We want to try to find a solution to make it to detect people more easy and give this information to the non-governmental organizations like Sea-Watch or Lifeline. So what's the size? To give you an idea about how big actually this area is on the sea, it's roughly 80,000 kilometers. This is only the area next to Libya, but this is a really huge area. You cannot simply cover it with a few boats. You need to find additional ways of observing the area to find people who are in distress over there. There are different actors, of course, who got an interest in observing the area. It's first of all governmental organizations, and there are Frontex mainly who got a system called Eurosur, which is a border control system, and it's not mainly about search and rescue. It's mainly about the search part of it. So they try to find people who try to cross the sea, and give this information to other state organizations. And they got a really high-tech surveillance system who is implementing this border control system. There are a lot of satellites and radar and optical, so cameras, and drones and planes and balloons. And with this technology, they can... sorry. They they can they can produce live streams which they So, yeah, they with this huge technology, they can produce live streams to detect individuals who try to cross the border. And there was a nice talk today already about this huge system, surveillance system. It's actually the author of the source I put in here, Martin Monroy, if I remember right. And if you're interested, what is going on over there, you should watch the talk, I think. And actually, with all this information, it's not only to search, but they also got a rescue part, at least in a few cases they're going to do it, because there's a law actually which says that you need to give this information to the MRCC, which is the organization which is handling all the rescue missions. Day one and no voice already. What? Okay. You should watch a talk of Martin Monroy. Okay, so let's continue. It's not only the governmental actors, it's also, of course, the NGOs, Sea-Watch, Lifeline, who do search and rescue missions on the Mediterranean. They are quite slow, so they cannot cover a lot of square kilometers per hour. They can cover like 100 square kilometers per hour. So they use radar systems. They have a really low resolution. It produces the pictures you can see on the lower right here, and they have a lot of noise. And they can cover up to 10 kilometers, roughly. They can also just watch until the horizon, and this is not far. And also, the people are on the ship, and they use binoculars to search the horizon for people. And this is, of course, really exhausting because everything is moving. And this is not an easy job to detect people in this way. This is due to the fact that the Earth is round. Some people say, I'm not sure about it, but at least we should, for this talk, assume it's round. So there is a table down here which says, on the one row, it says, okay, how high you are above water, and from this point of view, how far you can watch from this point of water. And you can see, if you're not really high above the water, it's the sight distance is really limited. If you want to cover a really huge distance, you need to go really high. That's why we also got planes who searched this area. So there are at least two organizations right now. It's the Moonbird, which is also which got some huge funding from the Evangelic Church in Germany, if I remember right, and a French organization called Pilotes Volontaires. I'm not French, so I don't know how to pronounce it, but they taking care of the flying part of it. So they need to. They get. They can cover a lot of kilometers. Square kilometers per hour, because they are really high and they can fly really fast. That's why they can do at least 3,000 square kilometers per flight. Still, there's still room for improvement, because we got a lot. We got 80,000 square kilometers, if you remember. So we need more planes to cover more sea. So this would make make the problem lots easier. So to conclude the introduction, what do the NGOs need? They need some long distance eye in the sky to cover more square kilometers, and they wanna also detect, of course, boats near the NGO ship more efficiently, because binoculars are a really inefficient way of searching for other people on the sea. And from this requirements, two projects emerge. It's mainly the drone projects, which you can see over here. It's the hardware, which is the current hardware of it. And there's another project which is working on a boat cam, which is mounted on the ship to search the horizon. But today we just want to focus on the drone project. So the drone project, it's mainly made from two groups of people. It's first of all it's the Berlin group, which is also here at the Congress, and it's of course also the group from Augsburg, which produce some hardware and also software to make search and rescue missions by drone more easy. And it's of course all open source, so you can try to help, or you can help if you want. So they both work on this kind of software and hardware. So we want to focus right now, what are the exact requirements for this kind of missions? So of course we want to search boats on the sea, but we also want to document like human rights violations, because there are a lot of them by the so-called Libyan Coast Guard. And that's why it's good to have an eye in the sky. The flights needs to be fully automated, because there should be really it would be perfect if there's no one on the boat who needs to take care of the drone. It should do everything on its own. The only input which would be needed is the GPS waypoints where it should fly, and then it should detect autonomously boats and send the information back to the ship that they can go there or not. The range of the planes should be roughly like 50 kilometers to have a huge impact on the search and rescue missions. And it's also important to notice that it cannot send a lot of data back to the ship, so it should only send the images of the detected boats at perfect, because that's due to the low bandwidth we have. We only have 100 kilobits a second, so we cannot send the full picture or the full movie of the plane. We can only send back the detected boats. And the most important requirement for the boat detection is that no false negative is allowed. So we are not allowed to miss any single boat. Of course, it's a really hard requirement, but we should do our best to fulfill this requirement, because it's about human livings and we don't want to miss any of those. It has to be also really cheap, because there is not a lot of money involved, of course, in the NGOs, and it should be not a problem if the one of the drones is left back at the sea, because, for example, the boat needs to go to this direction and the drone is flying into this direction, then you cannot come back because it's too far away already, the ship from the plane. So it's not coming back because the fuel or energy in the battery is too low to go back to the ship. That's why it needs to be really cheap. And it needs to be need to have a really easy usage, so everyone on the NGO ship should be able to start and manage one of the planes. So how does how does the hardware and a possible hardware and the mission would look like? So you have a boat, you start the drone from there, it's flying, it's to the GPS waypoints, and it's searching all the way from the boat, from the ship to the ship, back to the ship. It's searching for boats, and there's a radio connection which is used to send back all the images and information. And this is one possible solution. So you can use GPS beacons, for example, to mark the point where it should land. So with this GPS point, you just need to send this information to the plane, and it's trying to fly to this point back. And there's a net, and it's landing into this net. You can see it here, so it tries to fly into it, and then we have it again. Next, to give you a rough idea what this plane would cost, I was searching the internet for some prices of the stuff which is used. This is not the exact numbers. It's just to give you a rough idea. So it's somewhere between 800 and 400 euros, I guess, for the plane. It's not finalized already, so it's still work in progress. So we need to see how far we can get with this hardware, and then we can see what we need, what additional hardware we need. So let's go to the software part. As I told you, we got the user input, which is GPS waypoints, so where the plane should fly. And then there's the automated start and flight. It's done by using open source flight controller software and hardware. And it should automatically land by this GPS beacons I showed you in the slide before. So it tries to fly in the center of those to hit the nets, and then it's landed. And the bow detections are sent back to the mothership. Also to give you an idea how big the data is, for example, if we have a ship detected in an image, and this cutout box of the ship is 29 by 27 pixels, JPEG compression, we got 5 kilobytes of data. And if you use the radio modem we had in the slide before, which got in quite worse case conditions, it got like 100 kilobits a second. So we are still able to easily send back images from these detections back to the ship. And these images are needed because we always need to have a human in the loop, because it's always possible that we have false positives. So we detect boats which are actually waves. So there needs to be a human who decides, is this a boat, is this a wave, or is this something else? Or there are multiple boats, and we need to decide where we go first. So it's always important to have a human in the loop, so we need to have a picture of it. Okay, so far to the software of the plane, which makes it fly and do all the management, data management. And now I want to go to the computer vision part. So how to actually find boats in an image. The approach I took was a thing or a approach I called boat detection by tracking, which means you try to find interesting regions in an image. For example, interesting region would be a boat. We're gonna detect it at first. then we can assume that this boat is roughly always at the same position over multiple frames, because in relation to the plane, the boat is really slow. If we fly like 80 kilometers per hour and a boat is like 8 kilometers per hour, we can assume it's roughly always at the same position. And we also assume that region of interest, which can also emerge like waves, because they look like suspicious and maybe like a boat for the computer at least, because humans can differentiate, of course, really easy. Then we assume that they change over time. So a wave is going always in different directions. They change and they appear and disappear. And with this approach, we can differentiate between these two kind of regions by just looking at those regions over time. And a good thing about this approach is that we don't need a classifier, because a classifier got multiple problems, especially for our use case here. I'm gonna show you later, but for now, let's leave it like this, that it's not really easy to do a classifier for this problem. The negative side for this approach is that we need a good self-motion estimation, because we need to know how far we were flying from one picture to the next one, that we can calculate the position of the plane in the next flight step. The position of the boat in the next image. And you can see it down here. So we have a region detector, then we have the region. We try to calculate the 3D position of it, and then we track this object over time. You can see, I'm gonna explain it more in detail soon. So let's go for the for the region of interest detector first. So for example, we have an image here. You can see clearly two boats, and I made a software which is using like basic computer vision components to detect suspicious areas. So we first converting the color image to HSV image. It's a color space transformation, and this is good for our use case. Let's leave it just like this. I'm not going into details, but in these three different images we can get from the color image, we can then in the next step calculate the gradients or the edges in a way in these images. So you can already see on the right side of the slide that there are the edges of the boats are like seen in the image. In the next step, I'm going to add all these three pictures together, and roughly only the boats remain, but there is also some stuff in here which are the waves in the center of the image. Then I'm going to do an adaptive thresholding, which is saying that we only leave the 99% of the highest pixel values in the image. We filter out all the lower intensity values. Then we filter it even more to reduce remove small objects in this image. And then we do a thing called deletion, which makes it more fat in a way. So if we use these white boxes we had in the last image, we can put it back onto the color image. And then you can see that we have bounding boxes for our boats, and also some bounding boxes for some uninteresting stuff. But these are we gonna filter out with these two next steps. The first step is we have the 3D. We first calculate the 3D position of this region of interest. This can be done by using a camera model or the camera model of the camera. So we first need to calibrate the camera with a chessboard. You can see up here, and with this kind of chessboard, you can get the mathematical model of the camera. And with this mathematical model, you can calculate a ray through the image. Over here, there's a boat, for example. You can calculate a ray through the image to the real world. And then you have the real world position of the boat. And by having all these 3D positions of every boat at every frame, we can, in the next step, try to track them. So, for example, on the right upper side, it's detections of boats in two frames. The green ones are detections we had at the older frame, and the red ones are detections we had in the next frame. And then by tracking means we try to re-identify the objects in the current frame. So that's what we are doing. With the arrows, the thing we calculate are the arrows. So which detection is associated to the older one? This can be done by calculating all the distances from each old detection to the each new detection, and then running a thing called Hungarian algorithm, and this finds the best fits of old to new detections. And if we have a good fit found, so we have every single error calculated, so which new detection is connected to an old one, we then calculate the mean, basically, of these two detections we want to combine or fuse, and then we have if we try to calculate all these positions over multiple frames, we have we can try to find objects which are tracked multiple times. So as I told you, assumption is boat is standing nearly still and a wave is moving away, so only the boats will remain because they are detected over multiple frames, and then we only have the boats left or anything which is on the sea. But we cannot decide this because a human need to decide this. We cannot leave this decision to the drone. So we try to find everything with this algorithm which is standing still or roughly standing still at the sea. And with this information, we can then try to do a validation of the track, which is a next step that we, because I saw that there are a lot of false positives in the algorithm I made. My idea was that I'm trying to check how the shape of the object is, how consistent it is, because for example a wave or anything changing in a way, it produces different shapes, and a ship should be also have always the same shape. So this is like a simple feature which you can use to check for which we can use to check for more consistent objects and to filter out even more false positives. So another kind of approach would be that we check every single image for boats, directly for boats, because the approach before was like we look over multiple frames. And right now, there could be another approach which says, okay, we look at every single image and detect all the boats in it. The good thing is about it, it works on single images. And the negative thing is we need a classifier. And the classifier is learned in here. So we put a lot of images inside of boats, and so pro examples and negative examples from sea, waves, anything we also want to detect or differentiate between the two classes. And then we train this classifier, and then we can use this classifier in the online system to directly detect boats. The problem with this approach is, here's a small excursus first, sorry. So how is a classifier learned, at least? So as I told you, we have multiple images of boats and other stuff. We try to differentiate between those, and we calculate a thing called features, which is like a compressed information about this image. For example, one feature could be like the size of the object in the image, or the standard deviation about the pixel values in the image. And with these two values, we can learn a decision boundary. So the images are in the first step put on this like X and Y axis for the case of two features, and then we try to differentiate between those two by learning this thing called class decision boundary. And this learning progress is totally dependent on the data you have. So you roughly always need to have an image of the thing you want to detect before you want to use it. So we need to know roughly every boat we want to detect before we are able to detect it. And this is a really hard requirement for this kind of algorithm, which breaks our requirement that we are not allowed to miss any boat. So this is the problem of this approach. So it's really not easy to get a data set of every single possible boat. So this is why I don't like this approach. I prefer the other one, because we have more false detections, like false positives, but it's not so bad, because there will be a human anyway who need to differentiate between those two. Okay. Ah, yeah, this one is not working, so we are running from the USB stick. So we're gonna continue with the current progress of the project. The current progress of the project. Let's leave it at the plain hardware and software. These images or videos are from the Berlin group. I'm not sure, I haven't got any of the Augsburg group so far, but I chose to have the Berlin ones. So these are like flights from a drone they programmed and built, and it's trying to fly into a net to land. And it's working already in a way. So it succeeded also multiple times. So plain hardware is already roughly working in a way. This is the last approach. You can see here that the wing broke at the last time, so they need to fix it, or I think they fixed it already, but okay. So the plane can already fly, it can land autonomously, so this can be assumed that it's working. So, but this is the good side, or the what is already working. So they are able to land on the sea, on the land, but there were tests who tried to bring this drone to the sea. They were trying to start at the ship. I tried to land at the ship, but there were different problems which made it really worse for them. So there were first there were problems to start the whole thing. This is because the sensors on the drone, they need to be calibrated from time to time, and this can only be done for at least the IMU part. Is like the it's a sensor which try to find the position of the drone, but not the rotation of the drone in relation to the sea. So you always want to fly like this, but you cannot fly like this, because the wings it would fly into the sea. So you need to know what the plane needs to know what it means to be like parallel to the sea, otherwise it falls into the sea. And this is one problem of the drone. This is one reason why at least one plane fall into the water after they started it. So you need to find a way to calibrate the sensors on board of the ship. And this is really difficult, because mostly these calibrations are done by put it on the ground, like a still ground, and then if it's laying on the ground still, it knows what it means to be like laying flat on the ground. And on a ship it's always moving, so it's really hard to understand for the plane what it means to be like just laying on the ground. So this is one thing it needs to learn. And you can say in a way that the drone is getting seasick, because it don't know where up and down is, and so it's really confused about what it should do next, or what its relation to the sea is. And it's also the compass calibration is also really difficult. The compass is telling you, in which direction you're flying. Basically, are you flying north, south, whatever? But the problem is that it's got this kind of sensors. They got a huge influence from huge metal sources. So if there's a ship on the sea, it's a basically a huge piece of metal, and with this noise which is introduced through this metal ship, it cannot fly or cannot be calibrated. And beside the projects to start, there are also problems to land, of course. Not of course, but there are some. So there are a lot of strong winds on the sea, of course. So if there's a... they try to land, it needs to land really precisely in a net. So it needs to be really huge. But if there's a wind, it cannot target this net really precisely because it's moving away from it because of the wind, and it makes it really hard for the plane to land. One possible solution would be to make it land underwater, but to land it underwater, it needs to be really waterproof because the water, that salt water, is really attacking all the electronics and stuff of the drone. It's not easy to make a drone waterproof and make it cheap at the same time. Okay, so far to the plane hardware and software side of it. Let's give you a rough estimation what can be done already in the image processing part of the problem. Okay. Ah, there it is. where's the mouse? Okay. So you can see in here the image, the computer vision algorithm I wrote, and it's running on a data set which is collected by a plane which is flying over the Bodensee in South Germany, and we collected some images from a Raspberry Pi camera which was placed underneath the plane. And we also had some GPS coordinates recorded simultaneously. And you can see in here that the ships get detected on the image. And we can also use the 3D point calculation to calculate the 3D position of these detections in the world. So by using this 3D position, we can also calculate GPS coordinates, and with this coordinate, we can send back these coordinates to the ship, and they could go there. Of course, this is not a data set which we were collecting at the sea, but this is the best we have right now, and you can also use this data to run your own experiments on it. Okay. Let's continue. So, so far to the current progress of it. Let's come to the current work packages. So, what needs to be done next? So, this prototype I was showing you right now, just before, for the computer vision part, it was running on my PC. We still need to find a way to put it on an embedded board to place it on the plane. Right in here, there's a Raspberry Pi Zero in the plane, so we need to try to find a way to get the software on the plane. This can be done by boards like you can see up here. It's a board from Odroid, for example, or a Raspberry Pi 3. And we still need to test different boards. We need to benchmark them on the image processing algorithm, and we also need to implement algorithms in C++ because right now it's only Python, but a lot of low-level libraries we need to use, they are only available in C++, so I think we need to implement everything in C++ to get the most performance out of it. to be able to detect fast enough boats in the image. We also need to run get a classification algorithm for the tracking validation part. So we need to find some basic features which can validate these trackings. The thing I was explaining you with the shape consistency. So this needs to be done, and it should be better if we use. It would be better if we use understandable features, because if you taking contrary in contrast to this, like stuff like deep learning, where you have a huge black box, it's maybe not the right way for this kind of problem, because it's about humans on the sea, and we shouldn't put all our trust in this kind of algorithm that we detect everyone into a black box. So if we know the features we use, we can give more trust as a human to the algorithm, because in a black box it's really hard to trust it. We also need to test different concepts. There's also deep learning right here, but this is mostly for not running this ROI, this region of interest detector. It's about a concept where you directly detect boats in the image by using this kind of deep learning techniques. And we need to test this, of course, because it might run on these embedded boards, but it's not sure, because it's got a huge processing power is required. And we also want to maybe use available satellite data. There are some satellites in the sky which got like open data, and with this data we maybe also be able to detect boats. This was all for the computer vision part. There are also some important work packages related to the hardware to make the plane actually fly. So there's still the problem with the IMU thing, because the plane do not know what it means to be like zero. So you can try to solve this problem by doing a thing called data fusion or calibration against a known reference IMU, which could be placed on the board of the ship. And this would enable us to calibrate drones on a ship, maybe. So if someone got some experience in it, I would be really happy to talk to you. And another possible working package could be using a camera on a boat to calibrate the drone against it. Another possible thing to make a drone fly would be you place a camera in front of the drone, and then you get a picture like this, and then you try to fly like that. The roll angle here is like getting zero, so you're like flying parallel to the horizon, and you can also detect the pitch with the horizon algorithm. So if the horizon is getting always it's rising to the sky, you know you're flying down and you might fall onto the ground. So you want to avoid this. So I'm about to end. So let's look at the software I used, or we use in the projects. For the plane hardware and software to make it fly, there's mostly stuff from the Autopilot project or PX4 project is used. They got a lot of information and a huge and nice framework to make drones actually fly. For data streams, at least the Berlin group, they used ROS to handle all these communication streams between different clients in the network. For the computer vision, I used a lot of OpenCV, and maybe we're gonna use also the new thing called ARM Compute Library, because it's accelerating computer vision components on the ARM boards a lot, like by a factor 4. So it could get handy and useful the next time. For 3D transformation, interprocess communication, and visualization, I used also a lot of ROS, and I also used a lot of Python, because it's not C++ yet. Yeah. Okay. I think that's it. Do you have any questions?
Hey. Yeah, hi. Thanks for the great talk. It's really interesting and, of course, important. So I'm glad to see that. I have one question about the plane. How fast does it go, roughly?
I'm not really sure, but I heard it's like roughly 80 kilometers per hour. Is this right?
Okay.
Hi. So since you're using kind of Raspberry Pi boards with many sensors like cameras and accelerometers and GPS and so on.
Yes.
That sounds like what a cell phone has. So yes. Have you considered using cell phones for that?
Yes, it could work, but it's might be not modular enough. But it's an interesting idea because also the new iPhone, they got this fancy deep learning stuff inside. We might also use this, because it's a really like energy efficient platform, and it already got a battery inside, so it could be useful. Of course, it's pricey, but could get useful. Yeah,
thanks for the talk, very interesting. Have you thought about using infrared sensors?
Infrared sensors,
right?
Cameras or
right, basically looking or detecting boats and people by their heat, basically a motor and lots of people being heat sources.
Mm-hmm. There are like these thermal cameras. They are quite low resolution. So I was checking the prices. They are quite high. So ideally, it would be perfect to use a thermal camera, because then we don't see any sea at all. We only see one heat source, which would be a boat with people. This would be ideal, but the prices are still too high the last time I checked, so maybe I'm gonna check it again.
Okay, thanks.
Yes.
Thank you. Hey, what's the radius of the plane between the boat, the distance between the boat and the plane, and what is your limiting factor on the radio communication, the throughput?
It's basically the the radius. Oh, this was too fast. Damn it. So the radios are these things, RFD900X, it's roughly 50 kilometers. So the limiting factor, it's the further you go, the lower the speed is, of course. It's roughly 100 kilobits if it's like this kind of distance. I'm not sure about the antenna configuration, so maybe you need to use an antenna tracker to target directly the plane with an antenna to be able to communicate with it. I haven't built drones, so but there are some nice people which stand right behind you. Maybe you can ask them after the talk, and they have more information about the antenna radio modem system.
I have another question. So I understand that you don't want to use some deep learning algorithms because they're not really deterministic and you don't know what's going on, essentially. Have you tried approaches for image segmentation that are based on like partial differential equations or something like that?
I'm not sure about the partial differential part.
Basically another approach, just not like using simple filters, but where you can encode more information about how the stuff looks like, but mm-hmm. that is deterministic. It's not. I would love to try that with you guys.
Yeah, the main there are several problems with the deep learning thing that we, that it's need a lot of processing power, it need a lot of data, and it's a black box. So these are the things which are maybe a problem for our project, because we have limited processing power, at least for right now. We have no data or really less data to learn image segmentation network, which needs a lot of data. But if we find a board or also get more data, we need to reconsider.
Yeah.
This.
I really mean without deep learning, but maybe we can talk later.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
Cool.
Hey, yes, thanks for this talk. You mentioned in some part that there is a human in the loop looking again at what has been detected. Like, who's doing that and how often does this happen? So you mentioned that you are not allowed to do false. You will have many false positives. So someone then needs to decide whether this really is a boat or not.
Yes.
And how is this going to happen in this scenario you are thinking of?
The images are sent back to the ship, the Sea Watch, for example, and there's a human on a boat who gets an alert kind of thing. Like if it's working really good, I would say like every 5 minutes there might be an alert, and then someone needs to look at the image and needs to decide, is this a boat or not? This what it would look like. At least it's my idea. I have no idea about the organization on the boat, so I don't know how this could be implemented directly with the people on the boat, but this is my idea right now how it could work.
Does the color of the boat make any difference in the algorithm you created?
And the color, not. There were these. Let's try to find these slides. Yeah, here. No, the cover doesn't make any difference because we convert the color images to this hue saturation value thing, and the hue value is the kind of color information of the image. So every time there's a jump from one color value to another one, let's say from blue to yellow or orange because they're wearing some life vest, there's an edge in this kind of at this position. So there's one white spot emerging over there. So we don't differentiate between colors. We of course use the color information, but it doesn't matter which kind of color difference is there.
Do you know about any similar civil drone projects, maybe for other purposes than detecting refugee boats?
You mean for the hardware or computer vision, or
I don't know, like other drone projects use cameras to detect. I don't know.
I only know the two projects I put on the slides so far. So if there are more, I'm happy to get in contact with them.
Okay.
Hi, thanks for the talk. How will you be able to distinguish between boats that need help and boats that are just tourism boats, I don't know, from the resolution of the pictures that you have?
Yeah, this is
fishing boats here.
The resolution is important, of course. We need to see the hardware is not final. We don't know which resolution we're gonna run, so we need to have at least enough resolution to differentiate between fishing boats and other boats. There are a lot of different boats on the Mediterranean, so we need to find a sweet spot in the configuration to differentiate between these two. Right now, there's on the data of the video, it was like 0.5 meters per pixel. Maybe this is already too low resolution, but this is the current this is the current progress. So we need to get some more data of a real plane flying over the sea to get an idea what we're gonna use or not. But I think with 0.5 meters per pixel, it could work already, in my opinion. Because mostly small boats. It's mostly, I would say, people who are in distress on the sea and not fishing boats. Or I think you can also see from the people on the boat somehow. I think it looks different. And we need the human in the loop to decide. Otherwise, it's impossible, I think.
As far as I understood, this system just works on the day, right?
Yes, because there's a camera.
Exactly.
It needs to have some lights, otherwise it's hard for it to detect boats, yes.
So most refugee boats start during nighttime. Do you have any idea to solve the problem in order to detect the boat before they get into struggle, for example, with the sea?
For this kind of a hardware and software, it's not possible, I think. But as the other person proposed, a thermal camera would be a good idea. But so far, I think only on daytime it's possible. But yes, at nighttime we also need to consider to think of it. Yeah.
Maybe I can just add to this question quickly, because I think you all also use the SAR like radar images, and they should be independent from day and night, actually, I guess. So if you'd not rely on optical images by an RGB camera and just use SAR instead, it would also be working in the night, or even better, like another problem might be clouds or whatever you might have, or underneath, that would be also helpful.
Yeah, but the radar, of course, it's only on the ship, so you can only use it near the boat or near the ship. Yes, but the drone doesn't have any radar on it, so it's, so far I don't know any radar which is cheap enough to put on a drone to use it for this kind of purpose. Okay, thank you again.